Hello, everyone. As stated, my name is Dr. Carol Woods, and I'll be talking about land and the importance of land today. So we know that land is important. It's one of those resources that, you know, they're not making any more of it. So what I intend is to talk about how it's important to the individual, but also to the community and to what aspects that's going into. So land and the community is a non-dimensional, identifiable, and specific territory that provided the principal material and resource for community life. Therefore, it grows off of each other. The land that is part of the community makes it so those can travel there, move there, and then create some type of haven, some type of cultural background, and feed off each other. So we look at economically, politically, recreationally, how the land is important to the individual. Economically, we know that in America, the founding fathers came here to make sure they had their own piece of land, to get away from the crown that owned everything. So in this capitalistic society, being a landowner is a prerequisite for economical growth, development, and exercise of different rights like political participation. Also, economically, it's a difference between the have and have not. Especially in decades and eras prior, having land meant that you had a different type of status than those who didn't. Politically, we have to look at land and how it's important going from just the beginning of the nation, but also going into civil rights and now. So politically, you needed land to vote. There were Jim Crow laws and laws across the nation that said that you had to have land in order to be politically active and be a legal voter. So that was something that was very important, especially to sharecroppers who technically had land but did not have land and therefore cannot exercise that political right. If you go into the civil rights movement of the South, those Black landowners were the first to cast their votes because, one, they had land, but also they weren't threatened as sharecroppers were to be evicted, fired, if they were going to be politically active. Another way that land is used politically is through collateral. So sometimes those who had land could use their land as collateral to make sure that family members were not being put in jail. And that's just a resource that not everyone had. Again, the have and the have not. So moving on to socially, we all know that socially and culturally, we think of land as home. So those who were able to migrate with the Great Migration, they still had a sense of home in the South, knowing that they could come back to that land and be one with their family and their community. Culturally, after slavery, African Americans struggled for that full sense of citizenship, and they believed that owning property achieved that goal because it kind of crossed the bridge where you were considered property and then you were owning property, so then you no longer felt like you were property. You felt like you were a full person, a full citizen. Another way that you think of land culturally is how it's used even today. You have land that, you know, for family reunions, people come to the family land and they are together and fellowship there. You can also use your land for hunting, for fishing, for leasing. And then the stewardship of land through water, land, and just using that resource. Spiritually, land is tied into is tied in because it became a maintenance over small communities. Especially in the African American community, the church was the center of the community and it was used for multiple purposes. This is usually because African Americans were not welcomed other places. So that means that the church was used every day of the week. It was used for basket rallies, to raise money, to help those learn, double their schools. And it became one of those places where what came first, the chicken or the egg? Does the church have something there? And then people magnetize around the church, therefore buying land around the church, Or did they buy land and then say, we need somewhere to worship? So then they created or established a church, once again, feeding off each other and creating that bridge spiritually. So I've broke it down as far as, you know, the many ways that land is important. And so now it's going to be looking at some evidence of that. So in these pictures, you see myself and Dr. Zabawa. We went to a family reunion here in Macon County, Alabama, where we talked about the importance of their land. The land that we were on was Heir property. So we talked about the importance of Heir property, getting it cleared, and just making sure that they could still have that land as their own in the family. You also see a picture of a person hunting. Like, again, that recreation aspect of the land is very important. Another way that we show the importance of land is the community. As I said before, the community and the land feed off each other, and then the wants and the needs of the people in that community feed off each other. In the community of Heirs Barrett in Macon County, Alabama, we see that they created a school, and the school was not far from a church, but the school Heirs Barrett was founded in 1909, and then you see there some of the people that went there. They created a foundation in around 2008 to rebuild the school because it was such a pinnacle part of the community. And then in 2009, they had a historic marker dedication. And so now it's a lasting part of history and of that community. Going to the access of land, we all know the 40 acres and a mule story. So this gets to the historical part of that. We have Sherman's order number 15. And so this was supposed to only pertain to South Carolina, Georgia, and Florida coastline, but it was about 40,000 acres that were then supposed to be divided into 40 acre segments. And we know how that didn't always come to fruition. Another way that African Americans were able to access land without, as far as a government influence, of course, some were able to purchase land outright with cash or other means willed down to them by, you know, slave owners and things like that. But another way that African Americans were able to obtain land was the Homestead Act of 1862. And so here is 160 acres, and you could have that land if you were able to stay on the land, cultivate the land for 5 years. And so this was an incentive for newly freed slaves to move out west. And then two examples of these communities that African Americans moved, created a new culture there, is Nicodemus, Kansas, and then Boley, Oklahoma. And so there you see pictures of those communities. Another way that they gained access to land was the New Deal resettlement program of the 1930s. And this is during FDR's campaign and leadership. So the government purchased land and then made it available to landless sharecroppers. They did this across the Southeast. 13 African-American communities were established across the Southeast in different states. Here in Macon County, we have the example of Prairie Farms, where there was over-cultivated land, and they were able to move those African-American farmers, give them their own land, be part of this resettlement community, where they were able to build a school, where they were able to build like canning sites and things of that sort. And then the land that they purchased became the national forest. So they were able to use that land again over and became the national forest of Tuskegee. In Alabama, we also have another example of that in G's Bend in Wilcox County. So we've talked about the importance of land, and yet there's still a decline as far as African-American ownership of land. So these next few slides are going to go over that. At the height of Black ownership, we had 16 million acres. So this is taken from the census of 1910. And as far as agriculture, and I have to always say that because we have a lot of information about the agriculture land that African Americans have, but when you think of those who weren't in agriculture, you have to add to that number, and we just don't have those specific numbers. But from 1910, it was about 16 million acres that African American owners had and owned. Now it's a sharp decline, but we'll be talking about that as far as this video, and it establishes the value of land across individuals across America.
Well, it's a sense of ownership. I mean, a sense of ownership means a lot to me. Just like buying a house and paying for it. I mean, you work all your life and never own nothing, and it's not a good feeling, you know.
Land is very important. Even you read about land in the Bible, and that's what my father dreamt of. He dreamt of owning a piece of land, and I'm thankful for him today because I'm living on it.
The specialty of it all is that we have this property, that the 320 acres is still intact, it's still here, it's still a part of the family, and you know, and we hope to have it that way forever and forever and forever.
Land have meant a lot to my family because years ago, even in the community, the only thing that they truly could possess that had any value was land. So we do value land, but in this market now, if you have an overkill of land and don't have any way of creating income from it, you can be in trouble.
How I describe Heirs property is that it was a gift. It was a gift left by an ancestor who was forward-thinking enough to know that I want to leave a legacy.
Well, it was in my childhood days.
My father was born in Alabama on a slave plantation, and to him to be to buy this land, you feel like you're really free when you have a piece of land that you can call your own. You're not under them, you know? It means everything. It means everything. I love to see things grow. I get a thrill out of getting up in the morning and walking over there and see that they had grown a half an inch. We had to work. Because I was the youngest of the family, that didn't mean that I didn't work. I had a cotton bag when we were picking cotton. So I've been working all my life, and I'm 99, I'm still working.
Land ownership means the same thing for everybody. It's the ability that I have a piece of dirt, if you want to use that term, and I am able to do with it what I choose. If I want to plant trees, I can. If I want to grow crops, I can. If I want to sell it, I can do that too. But with Heirs property owners, their options are limited because they don't have clear legal title to their property.
People would be shocked at the predatory development and the outright legalized theft of Heirs property.
People want this land. Ironically, it was land that was often near water, which back before mosquito treatments and so forth, it was considered mosquito ridden and unlivable. Now it's some of the most prized property around. Any heir can sell his or her percentage, no matter how small, of ownership to someone else outside the family who, once they purchase that percentage, then becomes the newest member of the family, becomes an heir. And as an heir, has the right to bring a forced sale of the entire property in the courts.
His excellent land. Right, this is excellent property, and it's a dream come true for developers, but the goal is not to ever have it developed. The property was purchased in 1920 by 47 men that wanted the opportunity to fish and to hunt. They did that in hopes of preserving it for future generations, and that's probably our goal now, is to preserve this property for future generations so that we will have a place to recreate and do some of those things also.
When we talk to those landowners, the first thing I have to do is to make sure that they understand that no matter what we do to manage their land, it is their land. And it's their decision as to what they want to do with that land. We, in turn, provide them the education around here are some options as it relates to owning the land and as it relates to managing the land.
Well, for us at the Center for Heirs Property Preservation, bringing clear title to this particular asset and also helping them understand how to use it through sustainable forestry is the tool that we're using to help people and places move out of poverty. We really wanted to focus on helping families use their land, not just clear title to it and let it sit there, but we wanted to make the land work for you. And the way we're doing that is we were awarded a grant from the U.S. Endowment for Forestry and Communities earlier this year to operate a sustainable forestry program. So here's an opportunity for you to learn the techniques and the tools that you need to maximize your land, or in other words, to help your land work for you rather than you working for the land. Education is important. We don't want to do things for folk and they don't understand why it's being done. Because after this asset hit, or his the title to this asset has been cleared, they need to know how to use it.
If we can show an individual that they can make money and not just be spending money on their land and paying taxes, and they can make enough to either pay the taxes or put some money in their pocket or have money left as a legacy for their children or family members, I think it is a great way of allowing them to know that they can have an economic wealth or generator, and it can help knock a dent in poverty.
Well, it was the value and what it meant to you. I mean, what Heirs Property meant to you, what owning a title mean to you, land title, it means a lot. And what you can do with it, you know what I mean? I mean, because you can always, you own something that's more valuable than having a share, because it's yours. And then there's a sense of security. At a certain stage of life, you got kids you got to put through college and all, and you need something to help you along the way. You know, you got a couple of dollars, the bank know you got a piece of property, they jump on it. So it's, you know, it's to that person's advantage to have something they own.
To a certain degree, it touches every aspect of ownership statewide. And while we only serve six counties, I get enough calls from other counties, enough attorneys in other counties, to know it's systemic and it's across the state. So as success stories pop up, as we're able to clear title to certain tracts of Heirs Property, the Heirs Property owners around that individual are going to take notice. And then we're going to build that trust. It's going to allow us to move further and further into the communities and clear more and more titles. And collectively, hopefully, obviously, at a certain point, we're going to be affecting entire, not only neighborhoods, our entire regions, we're affecting a whole culture.
I am glad to be home. And I'm glad that I made this move. So if it wasn't for Heirs Property, I wouldn't be here today. This house wouldn't be here. And this is what the center's all about, for people like me.
The knowledge came from Heirs Property Preservation. And what I've learned in life, I'm 63 years old. Good things keep coming out of things that's of an operation that's doing something. I think they're doing a great job.
We're educating the youngsters as they come up. We educate them on the importance of what the property is for, what it was purchased for, and what it's supposed to stand for in the future. So this land will always be here, and it will always be here for heirs for generations to come.